This paper is already published, so I'll sort of briefly put in the central points. And two disclaimers that I should begin with is that Brahminism, liberalism, and postcolonial theory, I'm trying to see a certain kind of a convergence that has emerged, which is not to deny the differences. The question really is to raise as to how do you explain this convergence in the Indian context in spite of these differences. That is the question that is central. And one way to perhaps approach that is that these three ostensibly different philosophical and theoretical systems seem to get re-signified. Their political practices, the categories that they invoke seem to get re-signified, and that process of re-signification, I try to argue in this paper, is what creates this kind of a new convergence. And that therefore raises a set of new questions for us in terms of how do we conceptualize the question of subaltern agency. And my larger proposition here is that much of the categories that liberalism and postcolonial theory throw up perhaps might not be relevant for us, or perhaps might be inadequate in terms of approaching the new kinds of intra-subaltern conflicts, which is what I had in mind when I coined this concept of secular sectarianism, that secular groups are in a sectarian conflict in terms of other horizontally placed social groups. So what is the nature of this convergence? I have two broad propositions to make in terms of understanding this convergence between Brahminism, liberalism, and postcolonial theory in India. Generally, we are given to understand that these are three separate philosophical systems, and three of them have come in response. Liberalism through colonial rule and colonial modernity came to actually displace the hierarchies introduced by the Brahminical system in India, and postcolonial theory was introduced as a philosophical system to displace the imperialism of categories that colonial modernity through liberalism brought in. My point is that let us not read merely in terms of this linear manner, in terms of one displacing the other or progressively, but there is perhaps a circular possibility of there being a convergence between these three theoretical systems. It's a longer argument, part of my project on community, but I'll restrict to, since Professor Guru has already given me strict warning, to two points of convergence. I know why he has warned, because many of these postcolonial scholars that I'm critiquing are his personal friends, but in spite of that, I will go ahead and make this point, that the first point is that Brahminism, as we've been discussing since morning, I think is a unique system that combines rigid social hierarchies with capacity to accommodate. I think coexistence and conflict, coexistence and hierarchy, coexistence segregation, I think coexist in the Brahminical thought process, and that's very key to understand the nature of Brahminism in India. And one exemplar of this in one sense is Gandhi, the Gandhian practice of satyagraha. I think V. Gita referred to this idea that it lays a moral burden on all those who do not comply with that idea of. Therefore, the truth is non-negotiable in Gandhi, while the practice has certain kind of purchase. It needs an experiential dimension. It needs a dimension of living up to the consequences of that truth. That's the true definition of satyagraha that Gandhi gives, which captures this dimension of accommodation with non-negotiable, hierarchy with a certain amount of negotiation and accommodation. We can go on this, the multiple examples. I think liberalism, essentially at a philosophical core, also has this character. I think the structure of liberalism essentially has this character. And one good quick example to take is Mill's formulation on the distinction between freedom of thought as against restriction on right to action. This distinction between freedom and action that Mill makes, of course, on harm basis of harm principle and so on and so forth, but in its philosophical sense, a good critique of this is Herbert Marcuse's essay on right to be intolerant, or right to intolerance, which later Judith Brown volume on repressive tolerance again offers us this critique as to why this category of tolerance essentially leads to a status quo. That in keeping truth as an open-ended episteme, that you can never arrive at truth, but it's only a continuous process of dialogue, why does it reinforce existing patterns of power, I think is essentially at the core of liberalism. And in Indian context, I'm arguing that the unique product of this alliance between liberalism and Brahminism is the Indian political system, the kind of centrism that Indian political system follows. That the centrist model that we often laud as the basis for success of Indian democracy in South Asia as against its failure in Pakistan and so on and so forth, comes from this idea of centrism, which one quick good example is to Granville Austen's reading of Constitution. And he says that two unique processes are accommodation and consensus. He says that these are very unique to the constitution making process in India. And this can go on, this example of centrism in Nehru between private and the public, between socialist and private property, village republics combined with heavy industrialization, so on and so forth. There are innumerable other examples one can give in terms of the shifts that political parties like Bahujan Samaj Party have made from Bahujan to Sarvajan. So there's a pull towards a kind of a centrism. So this is based on this accommodative character that seems to be inherent to the political system. And this comes from both philosophical and social conditions produced by the alliance between Brahminism and liberalism. And what does postcolonial theory do? Postcolonial theory in principle has come as an opposition, as a critique of this nexus, of this hegemonic frame, in terms of attempting to displace and pose a challenge. But my own reading has been that postcolonial theory also in its philosophical proposition follows this pattern of accommodation and hierarchy. It opposes without really challenging. That's at the core of it. How does it do it? It's by this fault line that it draws between modernity and tradition, and by arguing that tradition is capable of tweaking modernity to the local sensibilities. What in essence the Bhadralok scholarship does, I should be careful because Dada is watching me very carefully when I say Bhadralok. Bhadralok scholarship is what it translates, this proposition between modernity and tradition, is that it offers a modernity for the East and offers tradition to the West. That it argues with the West that what you lack and what we have is community. And what it argues with the subaltern is a certain tryst with modernity. This unique alliance, or this unique way of formulating a sociological reality, I think leads to essentially reinforcing existing patterns of power relations. And this is, I think, visible, this core proposition of postcolonial theory is visible in innumerable tensions that exist in postcolonial writings that have been more or less left unresolved. For instance, the way they approach Gandhi, that he began subaltern studies, initial volumes began as a critique of Gandhi as a nationalist elite. But by the time you have later volumes on Gandhi, he becomes a symbol of indigenous knowledge, which is what Sumit Sarkar in his article critiques as a decline of the subaltern in subaltern studies. Similar is a tension that is left unresolved in postcolonial writings between Dalits and Gandhi. Postcolonial scholarship appropriates both Gandhi and Dalit, that it appropriates Gandhi as a symbol of indigenous knowledge and it appropriates Dalit critique as a lived experience. That's where I'm saying that how Professor Guru is co-opted into the postcolonial scholarship, that they're comfortable with Guru, they're comfortable with Gandhi, but they never interrogate the tension between Dalits and Gandhi. That why increasingly Dalits have rejected Gandhi is something that postcolonial scholarship leaves unattended to. Similar is the tension on Ambedkar. That Ambedkar, postcolonial scholarship of late has tried to sort of accommodate Gandhi, Ambedkar in their own writings, but Ambedkar essentially remained a high modernist. He laid faith on state and law and abjectly refused precisely because he did not trust the Hindu public community. That I think Ambedkar essentially argues that the Hindu community cannot be reformed. That's the reason he gave the idea of reformism. This rigidity that Ambedkar visualized in community is again something that postcolonial scholarship did not sort of interrogate sufficiently. And this is therefore visible in the kind of elasticity that we observe in postcolonial scholarship's claims, or the way they have framed their arguments. If you observe the shifts that have come in postcolonial scholarship, on one hand they claim an exclusivity or an exclusive localism to the subaltern, which can be captured only through indigenous categories. On the other hand, the postcolonial scholarship has been in a happy nexus and a happy alignment with the global shifts in theoretical frames. If to begin with, the initial subaltern volumes, Ranjit Guha's volumes, he was a structuralist. Elementary aspects of peasant insurgency was essentially an attempt of structural understanding of the structural understanding of peasant consciousness. Because 70s was a phase when structuralism and Althusser was at its height. You come to later part of 70s and 80s, you have the new set of subaltern scholars who make a shift to Gramsci. And they talk about hegemony, consciousness, culture as category, because there was a global shift to Gramsci in 80s. Come to the later part of 90s, then you have Lipesh provincializing Europe with Heidegger, because there was a global shift again from Gramsci to hermeneutics that has come in, the postmodern turn, post-structural turn, and finally the 2000s, when you have Partha Chatterjee's Politics of the Governed, which is Foucauldian in nature. And Partha Chatterjee draws heavily from Foucault in terms of governmentality, micro aspects of power, contextual negotiations. You can literally see the language, how it gets I think there is something here to be interrogated, that how come our subaltern is simultaneously so local and also so global. I think how do we explain this neat alignment of the subaltern and the postcolonial scholarship, which claims to actually displace larger Western theoretical frames, are actually in alignment with this theoretical. That shows that there is certain this accommodative character at the core of, and that also goes in terms of capital and social hierarchy. That's a longer argument. I don't think I'll have time to get in. I'll miss my second point. So I'll leave that argument there. My second proposition in terms of understanding this larger overlap is through the category of social separatism. That what is common to all these three theoretical frames, if one interrogates them a little closely, is this idea of social separatism. The Brahminism at its core argues in terms of social separatism of social groups, in terms of ritual practices, food habits, we are in terms of color skin, spatial segregation that is available, that concept of the agraharas that are at the core of the village. So there is a spatial separation. So we all know this fairly well, that how Brahminical system has a concept of social segregation at its core, the spatial and also physical sort of segregation. Very strangely, liberalism also seems to have at its core this philosophical proposition of segregation, of separatism, what I call it a separatism. Separatism of, how does liberalism, for instance, define freedom? What is its understanding of freedom? Its understanding of freedom, starting from Mill onwards, I'm seeing the eyes of Prof. Gurpreet Mahajan, as I mentioned, Mill. So I'm under attack from all angles, but I'm risking my life and still pitching these arguments. Is Mill's argument of freedom is in terms of how separated is the individual from the collective. I'm sensing a social separatism of the individual from social responsibility and obligations. Therefore, in liberalism, freedom is given. This idea of freedom is given, but the idea of responsibility and obligation needs to be justified. And this is a famous debate I have between Nancy Hirschman and Carol Pateman. That Nancy Hirschman gives this argument in terms of defining as to why this concept of freedom is essentially male-centric. The episteme is male-centric, is because it assumes individual this individual in liberalism as a male individual, because it assumes him as an atomized being, and therefore obligations always need to be reasoned, while freedom is a given factor. This proposition of liberalism, I think, gets transfigured in various ways, and that's one big part of it is, I think, multiculturalism. Multiculturalism, what it has done to Europe for the last two decades, is in terms of naturalizing social differences. That instead of historically interrogating those differences, what multiculturalism has done is, through a policy frame, naturalize those historical differences. And what it essentially argues in terms of maintaining harmony through differentiation, through ghettoization. This is what Slavoj Žižek refers to as racism at distance. That you distance them and maintain, there's a racism that is latent, but what you achieve is at a superficial level, a kind of a coexistence. So multicultural, if you go to any of the European cities, David will bear me out on this, there's a literal spatial segregation of all social groups. In Denmark last time, a friend took me for a walk, they clearly identified this is white colony, this is Hispanics, this is blacks, this is Bangladeshis, this is Muslims, and they think there's nothing wrong with it. For our Indian sensibilities, it felt very awkward. Because the moment Muslims are getting segregated in India, ghetto-wise, we feel it's a question to be raised, there's a sense of power there. For much of Europe, this has become common sense. That people do ghettos because that's what multiculturalism has done. So there is a deep sense of social separatism that is also at the core of way social and political practices of liberalism have pushed on Europe. And coming to postcolonial theory, now what does postcolonial theory, how does it maintain this social separatism? If you go back to its initial proposition on autonomous domain, I think it in a very strange ways, this idea of autonomous domain, of hegemony without dominance, dominance without hegemony, that the idea that there is no hegemonic impact or hegemonic consensus on the part of the subaltern, I think gets re-signified through these available discourses of social separatism in the Indian context, that both Brahminism and liberalism in terms of colonial modernity have introduced. That this idea far from breaching the hegemonic practices, they seem to reinforce that social separatism. And one way one can look at the n number of arguments that one can give, but let me pick on two or three arguments, is one, it leads to the ethnicization of subaltern. I think Dipankar Gupta reflected it on at length, that there is a kind of an orientalism within the subaltern studies, within the postcolonial studies, the way they figure out subaltern, is that there is a kind of an orientalism there. This is one quick example. The idea of the cult of the subaltern, that much of that what we have resulted today, I think this clash between me and Harish is a historical legacy of the postcolonial thing, that one has to dignify all that the subaltern does, because essentially the subaltern's locations democratize us. So this, and what I sense there is not a process of democratization, but a process of politics of patronage. That subaltern is not someone you reason out with, but subaltern is someone you patronage. Therefore, this Dalit critiques, and this is played out in very vulgar ways, and perhaps Harish does not have access to the private sphere of the Brahmins, which I have access to, is that those of them who support many of these arguments, like Kanchailai or Chandraban make, are mocked at in the private domain. The fact that he talks about Dicky, the fact that Dalit champion, or the fact that Kanchailai praises Modi to be, Kanchailai again another good friend of Professor Guru, praises Modi to be the Abraham Lincoln. These are all publicly defended by Savarna scholars. And they would make the kind of argument that Harish is making, that there is an innate sense of democratization in this. But in private, what we will visualize is a completely different phase of mocking, a different phase of sense of deep sense of patronage. And I think urban feminists singularly have done this damage to the Dalit movement. That by dignifying all that the subaltern does and reading a deep sense of political moment in that, I think we withdraw from a critical interrogation. Therefore, my argument would be that a critical difference in an argument with Dalit, I think, is more empowering and less moralistic. That's where my difference with Harish, than this kind of a post-colonial patronage of the subaltern that refuses to interrogate. It refuses to interrogate because it refuses to think that subaltern can, that one can reason out with the subaltern. One can only patronage subaltern. So this is another mode in which social separatism, and my final point in which social separatism happens is the category of community. And that is perhaps the only radical category that postcolonial scholarship claims has always remained an empty and an abstract category. They have never filled in historical or sociological meaning into what this community and what is the operational functioning of this the category of the community. And therefore, we have now what Jigme Bauman refers to as this fantasy of the community. The community is now a fantasy for all of us. Jigme Bauman begins his book Community by saying, community is like a feeling of all of us sitting next to a fireplace in a cozy way and having good red wine. David will get it in a short while now. So we are going to have a community at 7 p.m. So this is a community, but it's always a fantasy. Jigme Bauman says you never arrive at that. It only remains a fantasy. And I think much of postcolonial scholarship, community has remained a fantasy. It has never been filled. And that is where we need to again interrogate popular culture. I think I presented this in what Rajashi argued, function that was the seminar that he organized, Rethinking Political Publics, is this idea of popular culture. That is everything about popular culture liberating, the idea of folklore and so on and so forth. That there are innate aspects to popular culture which justify hierarchy. And those aspects of popular culture are also social in nature, they're not merely political in nature. And that's again my argument that I would ask Harish to interrogate, that it is these inherent aspects of our constructed historical aspects of popular culture which allow a shift in the subaltern towards the right, at least make that a historical possibility and lead to increasing possibility of intra-subaltern conflict that we are witnessing, rather than merely or selectively emphasizing the creative power of community as much of postcolonial scholarship has done. I think this selective emphasis on community also comes from the abstraction, which in a sense philosophical science I'm calling it as social separatism. So I will stop here, otherwise Professor Guru will follow social separatism from. Okay, I'll conclude.
Thank you.
Thank you, 1 minute.
Yes. You have to thank it. I am sure that, you know, both the presentations have generated a lot of interesting points for debate and discussion. And what time are we supposed to close so that the wine is not delayed?
No, we have time till 7 o'clock.
Okay, now Ajay has presented a very complex argument, the complex conversion of Brahminism, Liberalism and ECT, post-colonial theory. Of course, he has taken some parameters to really achieve this kind of loose convergence on these 3 points. There can be other parameters to really achieve this convergence or divergence. So I think I don't want to take much of your time and just invite quick comments, strong questions.